Hello, and a very big welcome to Bealtaine 2022 and to this conversation with the first ever recipients of the Fingal County Council, Tyrone Guthrie Centre and Bealtaine Residency Award. My name is Tara Byrne and I'm the Artistic Director of Bealtaine, and we are Ireland's national festival and only festival which celebrates the arts and creativity as we age. Bealtaine offers a platform to all of us over 50 who want to tell our own stories, to share our stories, and to listen to others, as well as showing how our creative potential can grow no matter what age we are. So I'm delighted to be introducing artists Una Sealy and Thomas Brezing, the very first recipients of this residency award. They're going to be in conversation with Dr. Éimear O’Connor, who is the director of the Tyrone Guthrie Centre. Before I hand over to Éimear, Una and Thomas, I'd like to thank them in advance, as well as Fingal County Council, the Tyrone Guthrie Centre, and our core funders, the Arts Council and the HSE.
I'm here in the Tyrone Guthrie Centre in County Monaghan today to visit two Fingal artists, Una Sealy and Thomas Brezing. They are the recipients of the inaugural month-long residency here at the centre in partnership with Bealtaine Festival, Fingal County Council and the Tyrone Guthrie Centre. This is a unique opportunity which gives both artists the time and space to work for a solid month within the house here in the beautiful surroundings of the Tyrone Guthrie Centre in County Monaghan.
My name is Éimear O’Connor. I'm the director of the Tyrone Guthrie Centre. It is such a genuine pleasure to welcome Una Sealy and Thomas Brezing here as part of the Fingal Arts Office Age&Opportunity Bealtaine partnership with the Tyrone Guthrie Centre. The two artists are staying with us here in our big house, and their studios are in our studio block outside. It has been really wonderful to see how their work has developed while being here. So I'm going to bring you outside and do an interview with the artists now in a few moments, and you will see what it is that I'm talking about. Thank you so much for watching. Una, it's such a pleasure to have you here.
Thanks,
a whole month. What are you working on
it? Yeah, so my idea for this festival was that I wanted to, because the Bealtaine Festival is about art, age and opportunity, and I have a friend who is a man in his 60s who has taken up pole dancing, and for me that just kind of, it summed up everything I felt about being a bit older, but being even, you know, that your life is certainly, it's far from winding down. In fact, it's actually
winding up,
literally.
Yeah, literally.
Up a pole. Yeah. And pole dancing is one of the most physical, most demanding forms of physical movement that you can do. And I have a huge interest in it because you, as somebody who's interested in the figure, and most of my work has revolved around it, you see the human anatomy from very different angles than you would normally do, because the figure is often upside down, sideways, there's limbs coming towards you, away from you, the figure is spinning in space, and it opens up just these whole new avenues of observing the figure.
And how have you been working? You've been on Zoom, haven't you, quite a bit? How does that work?
Yeah, so I did, so the drawings that are on the wall behind me here, I did from life, yeah. From my subject before I came here.
Yeah.
And I brought them with me as reference. And since I've been here, I've done Zoom sessions with my model. So it's been quite interesting because he is doing a Zoom class with his instructor in Berlin,
yeah.
my model in Dublin, in Fingal as it happens, and me in the Tyrone Guthrie Centre. So it's a three-way dialogue between the three, between Berlin, Fingal and Tyrone Guthrie Centre.
And sometimes our internet freezes, so that's handy, isn't it? As it gets caught up in post.
Yeah, so the very problematic internet here is more perfect for me, because in a fast-moving dance routine, when the internet freezes, I get this opportunity to really kind of catch up, even though I can tell that his instructor is sort of 5 minutes ahead and saying, no, left arm, put your right foot behind your ear. Yeah. And I'm still at the stage where he is doing something completely different, but frozen in time. Yeah. It's been quite useful.
That's useful, yeah.
Wherever I am, I'm always influenced by the surroundings. So I find it a bit, limiting to be just stuck in the studio and I'm doing this project and that's it. Because the environs of the Tyrone Guthrie Centre are seeping in and they're seeping into me and now they're seeping into the work.
Yeah.
So I've ended up, introducing elements of landscape and almost like the figure is moving through the landscape. Yeah. And in the process of that, I've met, the great thing about this place is that you meet other writers and artists, musicians, etc. And they're seeping in as well. So by some extraordinary stroke of luck, one of the writer poets in residence is also a pole dancer, Liana O'Hara. And so she has now snuck into my portraiture. So although I haven't painted her doing the pole dancing, I've painted her in the landscape. And I'm now working on my work seems to have suddenly morphed into a series of paintings of her. I have another two studies of her here, and she's going to sit for me again. So one of the traditions that was stipulated by Tyrone Guthrie is that there is a sit-down dinner at 7 o'clock every evening. And that has been a huge kind of, it's become a very important part of this this process. And also the fact that myself and Thomas are here for the whole month is that we have cycled through a couple of different groups of people. And you see this dynamic changing from week to week. But that the fact that I have, through this process, have got to know Thomas very, very well. And he is a painter as well as a writer. That it's kind of given me this into the whole sort of intellectual literary world. And while, in some evenings we've had musicians playing and the writers would read excerpts from their work. And then what I do is I sketch the other artists from other disciplines as they're doing their thing. And it's all become a sort of a cyclical, it sounds corny that it's like, cross-fertilization of ideas and everything. But I think that actually does happen here. I think it is actually a real thing. And I have really felt it. And because you've got a bit of time, there is time to do that. You don't feel like, I've only got a week. I have to be in the studio like 24 hours a day. Because the joy of the Tyrone Guthrie Centre is that you are meeting and discussing ideas with artists from other disciplines.
Being here actually on the residency for a month, what's it doing for you?
It's given me the time and the space to work on my visual work and to work on my writing as well, rock poetry, and I'm working on my second production.
You read something in there earlier that was really lovely.
I did, yeah. And of course, it's
about the poem.
Market.
About the poem. We can find it again.
Yeah.
That it's about the poem and the image,
right.
Is it?
That's right, yeah. It's about how the poet removes himself from the poem.
Mm-hmm.
And which is in a sense what I'm trying to do with the visual work.
Yeah.
It's very hard not to have yourself in it.
Yes.
But you want, in the end, you want the painting, not the painter.
That's really interesting, yeah.
So
let's just see if we can find that there now. Because it was a lovely few lines.
It says, the whole universe is full. Fantastic to feel how my poem is growing while I myself am shrinking. It's getting bigger. It's taking my place. It's pressing against me. It has shoved me out of the nest. The poem is finished.
It's extraordinary, that, isn't it? And that's applicable to your work.
Yeah.
How did this all emerge, Thomas? Where did this work all come from?
So it started about 4 years ago. I was on a residency in Creative Spark in Dundalk. And I had a studio to myself, and I had 24-hour access to a print room. And so many of them started off as prints, either screen prints or mono prints. These pieces, they started off as prints, many of them. Here, in this instance, the darker part, that was part of an old painting, which was oil on wood. And I inked it up and I printed it on the piece of paper. So it's a monoprint, but you can see the indent because the Fabriano is 50% cotton. So when you press anything into it, it remains as a what's the word?
Like an ancient track.
Yeah, so there are little flowers there and little people that you can still make it, and words as well.
So it is all about layering too, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I would do the same with oil on canvas. I put mistake on top of mistake on top of mistake until
it's not a mistake anymore.
Maybe, yeah, until something happens.
Yeah.
And it's sort of an inner picture that I'm looking for, because I'm not working with a plan in my head. There's no, there's no goal as such, you know, I'm not looking for anything in particular, but at the same time, when I've come across something, you know, that answers a kind of an inner image that I have, I kind of know that I've reached it, because I can't put another mark on the painting. You walk up to it, you paint, and it just won't let you do
it
that
stops
mark.
You.
Yeah, the painting is telling you, step back, you know, it's telling you when it's finished.
Wow, that's fantastic. There is a number of images of a person eating from a bowl. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so
there's one over here now in the corner.
Oh, yeah.
And this is you, isn't it, with the same bowl?
Yeah, that's right. So I made some drawings of my mother as she was dying about 3 years ago, and I was cooking for her at the time. And when she really liked something, she would take the plate and she would lick it clean. And all I would see is her hands and her face would be completely, you know, behind the bowl.
Yeah.
And I've written a poem about that as
well. Yes, Do you want to read that?
I'll read it,
will yeah.
I?
Yeah.
This is called Meals. And this is the poem that directly relates to the drawings. Your words are fewer, there's less of you. I cook everything to a softness, soft the pieces of bread for dipping, and softly forth you lean, more delicate than ever. A softness and tenderness now breezing through. I watch your head tilt, sniff, register the pleasure. How, when you really like something, you lift the plate and delicately lick and lick, your head deep inside the dish. The last meals I made, you ate them with the concentration of a hunter. Then you cradled the plate.
Mm-hmm.